Because Bono then came down that morning after that night, and he came down with the Bible and went like the Joshua tree, you know, and he looked it up in the Bible, and it meant a lot to him, and he thought that should be probably a title for an album. And then we went out that day to actually look for the tree, and amazingly enough, we found this beautiful tree, which we actually don't tell anybody what it is, standing on its own, because this tree normally grows in big groups. It's incredible to find a tree on its own. It's actually, I've never seen another tree on its own since.
Well, this is all about the bass and drums. And Adam, this is Adam, this song, really. He came up with this bass part, which is in a slightly, I think it's a different key or something than the guitar. It shouldn't work anyway, but it does. And Larry has a heavy foot. It is an extraordinary thing, you know, to have to stand in front of that drum kit. It is like getting a good kicking on a nightly basis. The ghost of John Bonham was an inspiration here on Larry, and probably Jimmy Page on Edge, because we all grew up in Dublin listening to Led Zeppelin, and as part of that blues experiment that, you know, that the Joshua Tree, you know, put its toe in on there.
There were two versions of Bullet the Blue Sky. That's right, I'm starting to remember now. Two versions of Bullet the Blue Sky, and Edge wanted to fly over from one version to another version. And in those days, nowadays you have samplers, you can put them in the samplers, and it's easy to move things around. Back then it wasn't so easy. So what we had to do, we had to take it off one tape, put it on another small, on the half-inch tape recorder, and manually by hand match the tempos by flying it in. So if you look at, I think Bullet the Blue Sky was never all played at the same time. It was a real mishmash of two things.